Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents 50 More Ways to Soothe Yourself Without Food by Susan Albers, PsyD. Narrated by Margaret Strom. Mindful Eating Manifesto. Being nourished and well-fed is critical to being at your best. To focus, create, innovate, authentically connect, and simply be the most amazing you. The first step to healthy eating is to focus more on how you eat than what you eat. It's perfectly okay to enjoy delicious food in a mindful way. When prepared well, healthy food is stunningly delicious and filling to the belly, and it exposes junk food as the highly processed stuff pumped with artificial fluff that it is. The comfort food brings is disappointingly fleeting. Hunger can be deceptive, and mindfulness can help distinguish emotional from true physical hunger. Whether you eat, snack, munch, dine, or take just one bite, always, always keep your mindful inner light switched on. Susan Albers, PsyD. Part 1. All about emotional eating. How it happens. Think of a time when you were infatuated with someone. This person was all you could think about. Maybe you spent a lot of time daydreaming about him, doodling his name on a pad of paper. You think you might be falling in love, but then you go on your first date, and the wind deflates from your sails. For whatever reason, you realize he's not right for you, and he never was what he seemed. In these tough moments, we experience the initial thrill of dating, quickly followed by a huge letdown. Perhaps you've had the same experience with food. You spend a lot of time thinking about, dreaming about, pining for, and imagining good eats. But then, once you have them, they don't always deliver what you had hoped. Your fantasy of how it would make you feel is much different than how you actually feel. Food has let you down. Let's hear from Melanie and her recent new relationship to food. Life was good until I got a new boss. Every time she walked down the hallway, I'd cringe. I'd imagine Darth Vader-like music playing as she approached my desk. I found myself hiding behind my computer screen, nibbling on candy and snacks. 95% of the time, I wasn't even hungry. At home, I'd spend the night in front of the TV trying to shake off the stress from the day and unwind. Inevitably, I'd be mindlessly munching on a bowl of chips. When that was gone, I'd rummage around for something sweet. I tried many things to quit this habit, distracting myself, telling myself to just cut it out. These things worked for a little while. Then I needed something more. I realized that I had gained more than 10 pounds in a year and a half. I believe it was 100% stress-related. If Melanie's story sounds familiar, you aren't alone. If you've chosen this book, it's likely that you too are well-versed in comfort eating, eating to feel better. Like Melanie, emotional eating may have snuck up on you. Many of us instantly and automatically reach for food in moments of stress, anxiety, boredom, grief, happiness, heartache, and so on. Why do we turn to food? There are many reasons that I will explain throughout this book, but the main motivation is that it offers some degree of relief from daily stress and tension. Eating a cookie or piece of cake can feel like waving a magic wand to poof away discomfort and anxiety. Within a matter of moments of biting into a chocolate bar, you can feel your anxiety level drop down from an 8 to a 4. Instant bliss. Some people drink alcohol. Some take drugs. Others go shopping. We eat. The sheer fact of the matter is that comfort eating works particularly when you want or need to feel better right now. Food is around us 24/7. The convenience factor plus instant gratification makes the perfect recipe for emotional eating. So, what's the problem? The moment of bliss is fleeting. It's clear in Melanie's story that the solution becomes another problem. Ask anyone just a few minutes after stress eating how she feels, and the story isn't pretty. What does she say? The list is long and often filled with regret. Guilty, bloated, frustrated. The emotional 180 is intense. Sometimes people even feel angry. One of my clients says, "How could I let myself be seduced into comfort eating again? I know it doesn't make me feel good after the fact, and yet I do it over and over and over again." This may be perplexing to you as well. Why do we continue to do something that ultimately doesn't work in the long run? This is a mystery that I hope to solve for Melanie and for you too. Since I'm a psychologist who works with comfort eaters daily in my office, I recognize it immediately when I see it. Melanie had stepped onto what I frequently call the comfort eating carousel. It's a cycle that goes like this. You experience stress. You need comfort. You eat something. You feel a temporary moment of comfort. Your positive feelings evaporate. Guilt sets in. Then you need soothing from this new guilt. It's carousel-like because it keeps going around and around. You can get off, but you have to decide it's time. And it can be very tempting to hop back on and say, "Just one more ride." Most of my clients don't worry too much about emotional eating, at first. Little bits of it here and there are often no big deal. But when emotional eating becomes your go-to method for coping with stress, your quality of life begins to plummet. Sometimes this includes weight gain, feeling frustrated, becoming upset with yourself, or isolating yourself because you are embarrassed or uncomfortable in your body. As you listen to this book, you will notice a couple of terms that I use frequently: comfort eating and emotional eating. These are both the same thing and may be used interchangeably to refer to eating that is related to emotion in one way or another. It is the use of food to lessen or avoid bad feelings, or to prolong good feelings. A subset of emotional eating is stress eating, which has the component of triggering a biological mechanism called the HPA axis, hypothalamic pituitary adrenal partnership. This axis controls your stress hormones and kicks your sympathetic nervous system into gear. It's this system that is biologically wired to make you crave sugary, fatty foods. All stress eating can be considered emotional or comfort eating, but not all emotional and comfort eating is stress eating. It's likely that if you're listening to this, comfort eating is no longer working for you. You may have realized that eating is a temporary band-aid. It doesn't feel good or provide relief in the long run. And sometimes, the post-eating feelings are worse than the initial ones. Perhaps, like Melanie, you've tried many things to put a stop to emotional eating. Some things may have worked for a while, but then you find that you are right back to doing it again. That is exactly where Melanie was when she walked into my office. She felt frustrated and stuck. She wanted some techniques to help her get off of the comfort eating carousel. If you're seeking answers and some skills to halt the cyclical habit, you're in the perfect place. In this book, you will find many exciting and innovative techniques. Some will be familiar to you, and others will be brand new. Here's a snapshot of what this book offers. a thorough explanation of the reasons Melanie, and you, fall into the trap of comfort eating time and again. An examination of how emotional eating works and why it's so comforting in the moment. Proven strategies for how to conquer emotional eating once and for all. Real-life examples of replacing emotional eating with healthier activities. All of the techniques I discuss in my books and articles, and on blogs and my website, can be described in three ways: easy, economical, and effective. Easy. It's important that any tip I share is simple. My tips are things that don't require a lot of time and can be done right now. They will not take you weeks and weeks to learn. And they aren't a struggle. They might take practice, but they'll result in less sweat and fewer tears. Economical. The tips are easily affordable for anyone. The majority of my tips don't cost any money. Some may require a few supplies, but even those have a low price. Effective. The techniques I share work. However, you don't have to take my word for it. They are all research-based tools. Therefore, although you may not have heard of some of these techniques, others have studied, researched, and implemented them. Their limitations will also be discussed. How to get the most benefit from this book. This book has been created to function like a guidebook, with a set of instructions that you can use whenever you need to. Listen to it whenever you need ideas to stop emotional eating in its tracks. It's helpful to start at the beginning of this book. It's advisable to start by understanding a little bit about why emotional eating happens and where it comes from. This gives your mind the opportunity to understand the big picture. Next, listen to the entire book. Keep an open mind. As you listen, you are likely to say, "Wow, that sounds just like me," or, "I'm not sure that would work for me." Take notes. Jot down the strategies that you'd like to try. But don't give up on the ones you're unsure about. You might find the solution you've been hoping for. Who this book is for? This book is for anyone who has ever struggled with emotional eating. In a nutshell, that is almost everyone. I'd like to meet someone who has not experienced emotional eating. I have not met anyone yet. Have you? It is also a book for men and women. While most of the examples may be of women, this is because the majority of my clients are female, I want to acknowledge that men emotionally eat as well. I've worked with men in my office, and many male readers tell me about the ways the messages in this book resonate with them. So don't hesitate to share this book with any friends who may be struggling too. Now, let's go ahead and get off the comfort eating carousel. All about emotional eating and self-soothing. Think about a time you went home for the holidays. Your aunts, uncles, grandparents, and anyone else who is important to you are there around the table. When you first walk in the door, you instantly feel comforted by the warm, glowing feeling you get. The smell of the foods from the kitchen and the sounds of your family are familiar and comfortable. You feel connected and calm. Then, all of a sudden, one of your relatives asks you a nosy question about your relationship or your financial situation, and you become uncomfortable. Maybe two family members start the same argument they always have. Perhaps another member of your family gets on your nerves with her strange mannerisms. Maybe the kids misbehave, or someone eats the last piece of pie, the one you were dying to try. All of these little things add up. Now you feel regret for coming, and all you want to do is get out of there quickly. This family scenario may mimic your feelings about food. You may want to keep this metaphor in mind when you consider how quickly emotional eating can make a 180 from pleasure to remorse. First, your senses are comforted and calmed by the familiar sensations. Warm and gooey, sweet and savory, salty and crunchy. But slowly, when boundaries are broken and your desire to stop eating isn't honored, the wonderful sensations you were just experiencing feel toxic. The good news is that you can prevent your family and food from making the flip from comforting to noxious by being more mindful of your feelings and responding to them in the right way. In other words, by setting boundaries and finding ways to calm and comfort yourself without eating. Often we try to force it. Your family or food was once really comforting when you were 12, and you want that experience again. But you're older, and things aren't like that anymore. You keep trying to make the situation give you the feeling it once did. Here is the main take-home message that I want you to get from this book. Overeating is not a problem about food. It's a problem of self-soothing. In other words, the issue we are really looking at is finding ways to calm down, de-stress, feel better, and get a grip. It's not only about fighting off food cravings for potato chips and cheese puffs. It's unrealistic to expect that you will throw away or avoid all the yummy food you crave in the world. Instead, it's important to be able to cope with cravings wherever and whenever they pop up. When you're able to manage your emotions, you no longer need to turn to food to feel better. The problem is that, from an early age, few of us are taught self-soothing skills. It's unfortunate. We need them. Think of a baby in a crib who wakes in the middle of the night. At first, the baby cries looking for some comfort, but eventually, with time and patient parents, the baby learns to self-soothe. Perhaps he sucks a pacifier, clings to his blankie, or rolls over. Life is incredibly stressful. Has anyone ever sat you down and said, "Here is a lesson on how to deal with stress"? Or have you ever taken a class on how to manage difficult emotions and ways to self-soothe? No. We learn how to cope with stress in a variety of ways, mostly by watching other people. Maybe you calm down the same way your mother does. Or maybe you came across a solution by chance. For example, perhaps you notice that playing a game on your phone helps you to de-stress for a moment. So you start to do it more often. Some self-soothing skills are very healthy. Sleep. Call a friend to vent. Take a walk. Others are not. Smoke. Have a cocktail, eat. Think for a moment. How do you calm down after an argument with a friend or loved one? Unfortunately, sometimes self-soothing skills can be downright harmful. Taking drugs. Cutting. Occasionally, comfort eating can develop into a more significant issue. Binge eating disorder has recently been accepted as an official diagnosis. It has been added to the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM-5. The big, universally accepted book of psychiatric disorders that doctors help use to diagnose patients. This is good news and a game changer. Why? It recognizes and pays homage to several things. First, there is a difference between overeating and eating triggered by emotions. Overeating is eating too large of a portion size because the food is there, or because you are unaware of how much is healthy for you to consume. Emotional and binge eating are prompted by emotions. Everyone falls somewhere on the spectrum from never emotionally eating to frequently eating because they are happy, sad, angry, or upset. Examples of self-soothing. This is a brief list of some common feelings, behaviors, and thoughts comfort eaters have surrounding food. There are many other examples. Take a moment and see if any of these sound familiar to you. Emotional eating, feelings. Eating numbs my emotions. The urge to eat is triggered when I want to celebrate. I feel relief while eating. I feel empty, so I eat to feel more fulfilled. I have feelings of guilt post-eating. Emotional eating, behaviors. Chewing feels good. I rummage through cupboards seeking something specific to eat, but I have difficulty finding just what I want. Eating right away after a stressful event is a habit. I stock up on comfort foods in case I need them. Overeating at stressful events like holidays or family reunions is common. I'm searching for something to eat, but can't find anything truly satisfying. Emotional eating, thoughts. I'll just continue to eat different foods because I can't find what I really want. I believe that eating equals relaxing. When upset, I think I need to eat something. I focus only on particular types of foods for emotional relief, like chocolate, ice cream, chips, and so on. I think about eating so much that I'm hungry right after I've eaten. I know that I am only eating this food because I am stressed. Integrative medicine, going beyond. Many of the techniques in this book are based on the field of integrative medicine, a more modern term for what used to be known as complementary and alternative medicine, CAM. This reflects the integration of alternative treatments with conventional medicine and research. Those interested in this field tend to shy away from the word alternative because it implies that a treatment is not generally accepted or is off the map in some way, when many of the techniques are not. To date, most people are more familiar with the term alternative, but throughout this book, you will hear both terms. CAM is traditionally thought of as practices rooted in ancient traditions that are often not in the core curriculum taught in medical school. That said, the popularity of these techniques is on the rise. They're starting to be a part of many medical programs and are being tested in clinical research. The treatments are often an adjunct or addition to typical therapies. Sometimes they even replace them. At the core of these techniques is the belief that the body is powerful and can be involved in healing itself. The good news, and something that is important to me as a therapist and clinician, is that the efficacy of many of these techniques has been researched and reported on in published journals. Several national surveys estimate that almost 40% of the U.S. population uses complementary and alternative medicine therapy in a given year. One large male survey found that the most commonly used techniques were relaxation, 18%, massage, 12%, herbal medicine, 10%, or megavitamin therapy, 9%. What does this mean? You might already be included in this group. If you've done deep breathing exercises or yoga, you've used alternative or complementary medicine. Maybe you've put honey in tea to soothe your throat when it was sore, or drank warm milk to help you sleep. Also, CAM. My grandmother was an advocate of CAM techniques, although she called them home remedies. She believed they were natural, less expensive, and for certain ailments, more effective. For example, when I got a sunburn as a child, the days before SPF 50, she didn't reach for a cooling spray to help alleviate the pain. My grandmother went to her windowsill and snapped off the end of an aloe vera plant, then rubbed the comforting, gentle substance on my burn. To this day, I make sure I have an aloe vera plant somewhere in my house for just that occasion. My guess is that you use some CAM techniques as well, whether you're aware of it or not. Some of the skills in this book may be less familiar to you, such as mindfulness techniques or the use of expressive arts therapies. If so, that is okay. They will be explained in full. Why would we turn to these types of techniques? Different things work for different people. Why not try everything that might work? Here is a list of reasons people have for turning to integrative or CAM techniques. You don't want to take medication. There is no Western medication or effective therapy that is available. You feel stuck. You tried other techniques and they don't seem to be working. You're bored. You want to try something new. Nothing is working. You feel frustrated. New circumstances bring on the need for more tools to choose from. Your personality is non-traditional. You don't like conventional treatments. You feel that your issue is more mental than physical, and you know that medication isn't going to get rid of situational stress. You need something that doesn't cost a lot of money. You want a skill you can practice anywhere, anytime, whenever your emotions or symptoms hit. You want a healing modality that recognizes you as a complete human being, body, mind, and spirit, not just a symptom. The goal: calm, cool, collected, comforted. Let me explain what you can and cannot expect from CAM techniques. CAM techniques are not a magic wand. So unfortunately, they won't go poof and take away all your urges for comfort eating. And they won't eliminate all bad feelings or discomfort. The goal isn't to turn off your feelings or make them vanish, although sometimes you might love to make that happen. Instead, the intention is to cool them off or turn them down so they don't push you to food for immediate relief. When you are able to manage and cope with your feelings, you can then create and choose healthier options. Life would be boring if all your feelings were erased. Also, emotions help you to make decisions. So let calm, cool, collected, and comforted be your motto and mantra. The purpose of CAM and integrative methods is not to induce a joyous or elated feeling, although sometimes this happens. The outcome we can hope to access is comfort and ease. Here is my disclaimer. If you struggle with an eating disorder, or if you have tried the techniques in this book and aren't getting anywhere, it is vitally important that you contact a professional, such as a licensed therapist, physician, or dietitian. If you have any medical or physical limitations, only participate in activities that your doctor or healthcare practitioner approves of. This is essential. If you are not sure about a technique, simply give him or her a call and ask. Fortunately, These tools can be an adjunct to or complement what you are already doing, even if it is traditional medicine. Emotional eating, why we do it. What happens if you don't address emotional eating and keep riding the comfort eating carousel? Maybe you turned a blind eye for a while, or chose to put it on a shelf until you were able to cope with it, or until your life settled down. If you are an emotional eater, it's likely that you already know what can happen by ignoring it. In the short term, nothing. Life continues as usual. In the long run, emotional eating that becomes your main way of coping becomes problematic. Emotional eaters often develop minor and major health and physical problems. Minor issues include frustration, weight gain, difficulty fitting into your clothing, spending too much money on snacks and junk food, eating unhealthily, self-consciousness, remorse, and guilt. If left unchecked, emotional eating has the potential to spiral into type 2 diabetes, eating disorders, depression, heart disease, and so on. The point is that it's important to take a good, hard look at your emotional eating to prevent it from mounting into something more serious. Or if emotional eating is already in full swing, learning techniques to stop it in its tracks will help mitigate or eliminate some of the physical and mental effects. Learning to self-soothe the right way. The need to self-soothe or regulate our feelings starts from day one, when you are born. When a baby cries, he or she has to find a way to settle down. Some babies are wired in a way that they settle down quite easily, even on their own. Others need help by being rocked, held, or talked to. Your caregivers played an important role in teaching you self-soothing skills, and you internalized the way they helped to calm you down. For example, my own mother always says, "Try and try again." It's like her personal mantra. I noticed that I say these words to myself whenever something doesn't work out quite right or I've made a mistake. Saying this to myself helps to ease the disappointment and encourages me to try again, even when I don't feel like it. I learned this from my mom. You also learn a lot from the other people in your life, mostly through observing what they do. Sometimes you take on or model the way they calm themselves down. You can often spot a person who doesn't have strong self-soothing skills or doesn't practice them when stressed. Small things can very easily upset them. Also, they have difficulty talking themselves through problems rationally, get stuck brooding or dwelling, have difficulty letting things go, or seek something outside of themselves, drugs, alcohol, food, to feel better. For example, maybe you've met someone who has fallen to pieces over a frustrating event like waiting in line. Imagine this scene for a moment. The checkout person realizes that an item doesn't have a price tag and calls for someone to get the price. The line comes to a standstill. Some people in line will say to themselves, "Oh well, this happens." They may look at magazines or their phone to distract themselves and pass the time. The person without self-soothing skills may start to get upset, tap his or her foot loudly, make comments, or worse. If you don't have strong self-soothing skills, that's okay. The purpose of this book is to teach them to you. But why does eating feel so darn good? Let's hear from Mandy, one of my clients. At first, I didn't think that emotional eating was a big deal. I rationalized that I was going through a lot. It was what I needed to cope. I had just gotten a divorce and moved back home to take care of my aging parents, and my children had gone off to college. One day, I stepped on the scale and realized I had gained 30 pounds in 1 year. I was so depressed. I felt like my quality of life had plummeted. In the absence of strong self-soothing skills, it's easy to turn to food to help manage feelings. It is a cheap, legal, readily accessible option. Yes, we know that food is soothing and comforting, and that we eat when we are feeling certain emotions. But why? It may be more complex than you think. Common reasons for emotionally eating. Let's review some of the most common reasons we turn to food when we need an emotional fix. The feel-good fix. Eating doesn't just feel good because of the sensory pleasure to our tongues, although that is part of it. There are chemicals at work when we eat. It's important to realize that food often changes our neurochemistry. Good food, for example, stimulates dopamine, a neurotransmitter that regulates pleasure. When researchers test the brain response of people who are overweight, they often find that the pleasure center of their brain lights up more intensely than others. What does that mean? It means that, for certain people, food just doesn't taste good. It gives an extreme amount of pleasure. Eating has also been linked to changes in serotonin level, which is also boosted by taking antidepressants. In many ways, you could say eating is like taking a food antidepressant for some. Stress and an effort to rebalance. We tend to eat more when we feel stressed out. In part, it's due to the stimulation of the HPA axis, hypothalamus, pituitary gland, and adrenal glands, which is triggered when you feel overwhelmed. Your body becomes flooded with cortisol, the hormone that makes you crave sugary, fatty, calorie-dense foods. There are biological reasons for this. In caveman times, when you were stressed, you needed all the energy you could muster to fight off the threat. Think lion. Now you are no longer faced with lions, but smaller things cause your system to click into a stressed-out mode, nevertheless. Studies show that increases in cortisol predict an increase in body mass. That means, when stressed, people work less to restrict their eating and are driven to eat to feel better. It explains why we often crave good food when feeling overwhelmed by a work project or the constant audible alerts of a mobile phone. More, please. Eating prolongs positive feelings and sometimes elevates them. If you feel happy, sometimes food makes you feel even happier, and for a longer period of time. It's a myth that we only eat emotionally when we are sad. In fact, studies show what happy people like to munch on most. Pizza, steak, and popcorn are favorites. Accessibility. Let's face it, comfort foods are everywhere. It's hard to escape them. We often have access to sugary, fatty food 24/7. The convenience factor makes it an attractive way to calm and soothe ourselves. It's easy, sometimes too easy. Media diet. We often turn to comfort foods when stressed because of what we expect to happen, based on the media and ads, which often link foods with certain emotions. Think about chocolate ads, for example. They're often tied to words like bliss, relaxing, you deserve it, escape, and so on. When these foods and words are paired repeatedly, people begin to expect these emotions to follow after eating. One of the best examples of this relates to a woman's menstrual cycle. Numerous TV shows, ads, and pop culture suggest that women crave chocolate during their period. Research actually indicates otherwise. To date, there is no known clear biological reason for craving chocolate during menstruation. Society suggests that women expect to crave it. Therefore, they do. Thumb twiddling. Sometimes people eat out of sheer boredom. You don't know what else to do, and eating fills a block of time. One of the things that you will learn in this book is how to be okay with downtime. Giving yourself permission to have free spaces of time without doing something and learning how to tolerate boredom is important. This isn't always easy, but it's essential if you are going to kick the boredom eating habit. Habit. A significant portion of emotional eating is nothing more than habit. You do it, like brushing your teeth or your hair, because it's what you always do. It's part of a routine. The good news is that you can break or rework habits. They aren't set in stone. So if you suspect that you comfort eat out of mere habit, we can change that. Distraction. One theory is that eating distracts from emotions. When you're eating, you're focusing your mind in a different direction. Instead of dealing with how upset, angry, tearful, hurt, or fearful you are, you eat. Ignoring internal cues. When stressed, sometimes people become insensitive to their internal cues of hunger and fullness. As a result, you confuse emotional arousal, an increase of feelings, as hunger. So if you're not tuned in to your internal cues, you're more vulnerable to eating when stressed without even realizing it. Alexithymia. The condition in which people have difficulty putting their feelings into words is called alexithymia. The more trouble you have talking about or expressing your feelings, the more likely you are to emotionally eat. Impulsivity. You simply don't stop to consider decisions fully, but impulsively grab for something to put in your mouth without thinking about it. Self-soothing reflection. Now that you know the reasons that people engage in emotional eating, take a moment to answer the following two questions. Write your answers down in a journal so you can reflect on them later. Which of the reasons listed on the previous pages describe why I engage in emotional eating, comfort eating, or stress eating? What do I gain emotionally from comforting eating? Perhaps relief, a sense of calm, happiness, entertainment? Where to go from here? As you've learned from this chapter, food is soothing. You wouldn't overeat if it didn't work to calm you down and make you feel better. The good news is that there are other activities and strategies that will make you feel okay, but won't lead to weight gain, regret, or guilt. Before we get to them, however, there are a few more things very much worth knowing. 15 things you didn't know about emotional eating. Here are some interesting facts I've discovered in my research on comfort eating. You only get a 3-minute fix. A study reported in the journal Appetite gave participants chocolate and tested how long the feel-good feeling lasts. It turns out that comfort and bliss only last 3 minutes. 3 minutes! Isn't it a surprise how short-lived comfort eating can be? Cake plus guilt equals less weight loss. Cake is a comfort food that can be associated with guilt and worry or pleasure and enjoyment. In a study of dieters, those who associated cake with guilt, as opposed to celebration, were less likely to lose weight over a 3-month period. Those who had positive feelings and associated cake with being a comfort food were more likely to lose weight during those 3 months. The take-home message? Guilt can derail your efforts. Comfort foods are not cross-cultural. Have you assumed that chocolate is the go-to, feel-better food everywhere in the world? It's not. People in different countries find comfort from various foods. For example, in Japan, miso soup, okayu, rice porridge that is made when children are sick, and ramen are popular comfort foods. In India, it's samosas, potato-stuffed crisps served with spicy green chutney. In Italy, it's ribbons of fresh pasta or potato gnocchi. When I was visiting Japan, my host family was appalled by the super sweet chocolate I brought for them to try. Their tongues were not used to it. This was clearly not one of their comfort foods, to my surprise. There's a gender difference. According to one study, males prefer warm, hearty, meal-related comfort foods, such as steak, casseroles, and soup, while females prefer comfort foods that are more snack-related, such as chocolate and ice cream. We choose out of habit. When we're stressed out, we tend to revert back to the foods we frequently eat, whether they are healthy or not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.